Welcome, friends, to this monthly meeting that we have in order to remind ourselves that the most important thing in a human life is to go back to our true home, which we can only do during this period. It comes not very often, so we just want to remind ourselves to give the highest priority to our spiritual journey. I have been sharing with you several stories and several teachings of great master Zur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh. Some people say, you keep on repeating the same thing, why don't you come up with something new? Well, this question was asked by one of the followers from great master, who used to repeat the same stories again and again. So when he asked him, Master, you repeat the same stories, why don't you say something new? Great master said, have you started meditating 2.5 hours? He had no answer. He says, I have to repeat again and again till you start doing that. But anyway, today I thought I should share with you something little different and new. It is also from within the great master's teachings, but has not been presented this way. And that is, when we say we are old, like I am now got old, 92 years, 93 years, when we say we are old, what makes us old? If the soul is immortal and has no age, we sometimes say, this person has an old soul. How are we giving this definition of old, of age, even to a soul? What does it really mean when we talk of age? So I am going to talk to you today what age means in our experiences. When we are born as a human being, our age starts from the date of birth. And we keep on growing, and the age is dependent on the age of the human body. It does not take into account the age of what is inside the human body. It does not take into account the age of the astral body, nor of the causal body, and of course, nor of the ageless soul. So that is why when we talk of age, we are talking very primarily of the age of the clothes we are wearing. I can say I'm wearing a very old jacket of mine, the age of the jacket. In the same way, when we describe our age, we are describing the age of one of the bodies we are wearing. As it happens, the age of the physical body is very limited. It is limited because when we try to remember when we were young, we go only so far, and nobody has ever gone to beyond the date of birth to say, I remember anything before that, so far as the body is concerned. So the age of the body is very limited because the memory connected with this body is very limited. Now, what is memory? I have often said that memory is a very important subject to study. If you want to know how you remember things, you will notice this is a function of the mind. Mind holds all memory, whether it is memory of the physical body, or memory of the astral body, or memory of the causal body. So since the memory can go only as far as the birth of the body, so when we say he's got an old astral body, we are referring to the memory that can be obtained when we are at the astral level and can remember things as far back as we can. When we say his mind is very sharp, old, matured mind, we're talking of the age of the causal body, the causal self, the mind, and how much it can remember, how far it can go. So that is why when we say the memory of a soul, soul does not have memory, it has knowing, awareness. It has totality of memory is part of its awareness. Memory is generated only through a very small fraction of the total awareness. That is why when we say an old soul, we are not referring to the soul at all. We are referring to the soul's existence in these different bodies for a long time. If a soul has been born again and again in different forms, we say it's an old soul. So we're not referring to the age of the soul, but the age of the bodies in which the soul has existed. So that is why the memory that we can use to go back is a determinant. Now, I have often explained the role of memory in the creation of time and space. I have said that if we want to look at time and space carefully, we will notice that the only time in which we live is now. Nobody is living outside of now. So when somebody said, live in the now, I said, I want to meet a person who is not living in the now. We are all living in the now. And now is the present, which has no time at all. It's a meeting point of the past and the future. It is not even a millionth part of a nanosecond. So now in which we live is timeless. And how are we living? How are we experiencing time? We are experiencing time through memory. What we remember happened a few seconds ago becomes our present. If we don't remember anything, we'll have no time at all. We will have no life at all. And therefore, it's the memory of our immediate few seconds, few minutes before, which we are calling the present. Present itself, if it's defined as now, has no time at all. So the now, the present, is merely recent past. Very recent past we are terming as present. I'm talking to you, after I speak a few words, I say I'm talking in the present, but they are all really in the past. That is why the past is being created through memory. If there was no memory, there'll be no past. If there's no past, there'll be no time. There won't even be now. So that is why our experience of time is going through memory only. Similarly, our experience of space is going through memory. He didn't have any memory, there would be no space either. Space and time go together. In fact, time is created first, before space is created. So that is why we have all past, which we call past and present. And when we say future, future itself is also memory. In what way? That if we did not have the opportunity to hope for anything, to anticipate anything, or to fear anything, if you remove these three functions of the mind, hoping, fearing, anticipating, which are all the same thing, hoping is positive, fearing is negative, anticipating is neutral, but they're all the same function of the mind. If you don't have these three, there's no future either. You examine, can you have a future without these three functions? None at all. But when we think like that, the thinking that creates these thoughts are also in the past, and therefore what we think is the future is actually also the past. Moreover, there are so much evidence that people can tell events of the future very clearly. And I gave an example of a man who was able to tell me exactly what I will think in the next 5 minutes. So that means even that what we call future is also written up earlier. And what we call written up earlier is our definition of past. So that is why there's nothing in time and space that creates our feeling of past, present and future except memory. Now, where does memory come from? If memory is a secret, how we can remember things, if that is the whole secret of time and space, we can look back in meditation and go to the causal plane where we discover memory is being generated. Memory is being produced. Memory is being created in the form of events that we remember. When we say we are being born, it becomes an event and we remember it and we are born, and the experience takes place here as if we are really born. That is what I have been calling a DVD of our life. A DVD is a preparation, a set of memories put together that constitutes our life. Our life here, what we are living here, is nothing more than a set of memories being played out in such a way they look like past, present and future. This is not an easy subject to simulate, but I am presenting it to you. So you examine. If you find any flaw in it, let me know that if there was no memory, there would be no past, present and future. And therefore, the memories that are being generated are actually the DVDs of our life that we speak of. Now, when this is manufactured, who manufactures it? Our own mind. But not the mind in the body, which we call the pindi mind or the physical mind. That cannot do much of it at all. It cannot even change the memories. It can take part in intention and action, which looks like acting into the future, which is also part of the original memory. But the original memory is only created at the causal plane. If you are able to meditate deep enough to go to the causal plane, you will discover that is where the memories are being generated, which are creating life. Since we do not understand the full nature of memory, how it works, we call it a DVD is being played. That means all the events that a memory can produce are encoded and made into a DVD, or what we call the life forms that are creating the causal life, they're creating the astral life, and they're creating the physical life. When it's created, we create at the top of the causal plane, which comes down into the bottom of the causal plane. These are vast experiences in causal plane, very large experiences. So are the astral plane experiences, very large. They are not very simple experiences. If you spend time there, you can go and see a lot. So when the causal plane you see at the top, that is the, they call it the top of the Trikuti, or top of the three phases from which past, present, and future are being created, that's where the memories are being stored and created. It's a very wonderful way how this life is being developed only as a way to play out a show, a drama. We are the makers of this film. We are the directors of the film. We are the script writers of the film, but only at the causal plane. When we design this, we do not design a play in which only we are participating. We design a play in which the whole universe comes into being. So it's a very big thing. Now, you might say, are we all designing different plays? Yes, we are. But when we play what we have designed there, when we play here, the characters that come are the characters of our play, not anybody else's play. We have no idea what the play of anybody else is. We don't even know if there is anybody else. All we know is that one single unit of a mind can create a whole universe of people, billions of people, and billions of characters, billions of different types of universes it can create in which the experience can be held. Now, when we talk of one unit creating all this, often the reference is made to the fact that what we consider an individual mind is actually participating in one universal mind. The universal mind is one single entity from where all plays are originating, but since the play that originates from the universal mind creates billions of beings, trillions of beings in different forms, therefore it looks like that we are all individual, separate, and from here we are creating something. Nothing is being created here. Only one experiencer is here, the self, and all others are the creation of that self at a different level. So that is why it's not easy to assimilate this sitting here when we think we are so many. Are we doing these things? I sometimes give an example that when we go to sleep and have a dream, in the dream we can see 100 people, and we ask each other, who is dreaming? Who is creating this scene? Are there many dreamers? Are there only one dreamer? We keep on questioning, then more people come in, thousands of people can come in, billions can come into a dream, and yet when we wake up, it is only one person dreaming, and all the billions are part of the same dream, and there were not billions of people who were dreaming. But it can happen that some of those characters that we saw in a dream were also live characters on wakeful state, which means that the dreams we create at a certain level can have characters which also exist at another level. For example, I can have a dream with 100 people I meet, they are all strangers except I recognize three friends of mine in that crowd of 100. When I wake up, those three are alive, I know them, they are my neighbors. But the remaining 97 were just created for the sake of the dream. Supposing there is a way to wake up further, and I find that the three friends I knew, I thought they are real. But when I wake up again, I find two of them were just created for the wakeful state. Only one was real. So when we awake to a higher level, we discover the oneness of this experiencer, the oneness of the dreamer, the oneness of the creator. And this waking waking up can go on till the end when we discover right at the top that there was only one real friend who was there all the time in every dream of ours, and that friend we call a perfect living master. He happens to be in the part of the dream. He's also there when we wake up. He's also there when we wake up again. And he's also there at the end. And the final wake up shows that the one friend who we thought was the only real one after all wakefulness was also part of the self. And there was only one self having even the power of dreaming up a perfect living master. This is such a beautiful setup. The way we have created these experiences is so amazing. I cannot find a better way of doing it. I cannot even imagine a better way of creating universes in this way. And it's all based upon one single thing, the power of consciousness to be conscious of anything it wants to be. It's the power of consciousness. Consciousness is a power. It's a power that creates what it wants to be conscious of. And what it creates to be conscious of becomes creation. And this is all created by consciousness at different levels. The fact it has divided itself into so many levels of itself, levels of consciousness, makes the drama not only interesting, but the wakefulness process becomes more interesting, that you can wake up from one level to another and keep on awakening to higher levels. This is such a beautiful way to set up any experience. Of course, we have set up experiences which are wonderful, blissful, great, and we have also set up experiences which are not so great. We have created the power of duality, the power of pairs of opposites to generate different kind of experience. Here we are sitting in a physical world. This is a world of pairs of opposites. Everything happens in opposites. And the experience generated here for the self is the one that is only enhanced by its opposite. In fact, it only exists because of its opposite. For example, a person who has never known unhappiness cannot really define what happiness is. A person who has never experienced pain can never really define what pleasure means. A person who has never seen darkness cannot explain what light is. We are able to experience them at this level, everything based on pairs of opposites. And the same thing happens at the astral plane. It's a much wider plane. The possibility of experience enhances considerably. Here we are wearing a physical body that limits the experience we can have. For example, with a physical body we cannot fly. We have to go into an aeroplane. We have to go into a helicopter. We have to use other means of moving. We can't even go long distances except using cars and vehicles. Look at the limitation of movement that this physical body has imposed upon us. Take the physical body away, the rest of us can move so fast and go anywhere it likes. It's completely light. All it consists of is our self and our mind and our astral self. What are these selves? What are these bodies? The mind is a thinking machine. It makes us think, creates time and space, creates place for us to fly into. And the astral plane is merely made up of our sense perceptions. The sense perceptions cover ourselves, cover our mind, and therefore we can see, touch, taste, smell with those sense perceptions. Therefore, we become an entity, become a self that can do all these things through sense perceptions. All our experience in the physical plane and the astral plane is totally 100% based upon our sense perception. If the sense perception disappears, the world disappears completely. There is no other way in which we can know anything about the experience outside of ourselves except through sense perceptions. Now here the body is hiding the sense perceptions inside us, so we can't fully use them. But when the body is not there, we can more fully use it. It's a different experience. It becomes so light. Somebody wrote to me yesterday, and thinking that the matter and antimatter, maybe they are so different and we are living in a world of matter. And maybe astral plane is a world of antimatter. So he asked me, is the world of astral plane made up of antimatter? I said, not at all. Antimatter is just like matter. It's also physical. It's just a different part of matter. When matter is created, antimatter is simultaneously created and lies alongside the matter, which they will discover. They are discovering slowly already. The science will discover a little more about it. The astral plane consists of no matter, but sense perceptions, which are being used by us here for experiencing matter. Therefore, sometimes people have called the experiences that happen at the astral plane as some sort of super matter, some type of very fine matter. So they call it the suksham matter. Sometimes they call our body suksham, which is a very fine matter. But it's not matter at all. It's the ability to have an experience similar to the experience we are having with matter, but much better experience. Because the physical body hides a lot of our sense perceptions. We think it enhances. We think these organs that we are using on a physical body, for example, the organs of vision, eyes and all, these are helping us to see. Because when we close our eyes, we cannot see. We think seeing is a function of the brain, the optic area, the optic nerve, and it's functioning only through the eyes. If this were so, we could never imagine anything and see. We could never see anything in dreams. Because in dreams and imagination, this optic apparatus is not working at all. Yet seeing is identical to this. So that is why we can see a lot more if this barrier of the physical body were not there. Seeing is not taking place because of the body. Seeing is taking place because of the astral sensory systems. When we are alive, our astral self is completely within this body, functioning, overlapping virtually this body, and therefore we feel the sense perceptions are connected with the organs and tissues of the body. They are not. That is why when we meditate and withdraw our attention from the body, we find the sense perceptions are not only retained, they become very sharp. We can see much better without the body, with the eyes. And sometimes you can even test it out. The imaginary self that we believe can see, touch, taste, smell, there's no imaginary self of ours, it's our own self in the astral form. And that is why we are able to do all the things with the sensory system. But the sensory system is not necessary for perception. For experience, we believe that we need a sensory system, we are tied down to the physical body. Supposing we get ourselves relieved from the physical body through meditation or through death, then we find astral self good. Supposing we relieve ourselves even of the astral body by meditation or by death of the astral self, perception becomes sharper, not weaker. And yet there are no different sense perceptions. The perception that the mind can have is direct perception and covers all the sense perceptions together. This is a unique feature of the mind. Sometimes accidentally, even in the astral plane, the sense perception can get mixed up. In the physical plane, they have identified at least 300 odd cases where there are children who are born who can see with the ear and hear with their eyes, which is very unusual. The optic nerve and the oral nerve are misconnected, disconnected, not connected properly. So those are rare cases, but this is merely showing that these sense organs of ours are not really responsible for it. The optic nerves generating from the brain are doing it in the physical self. The astral self, they are doing it from the astral brain, astral mind, and from the mind itself, they are being generated through the power of perception is divided into these five senses separately. That's a great experience. When we leave our astral self through meditation, we can have a perception of the experiences, all experiences, including experiences that look like the same experiences like this physical world and astral world. All are perceived directly by ourself, by the mind, and that is why perception is different from sense perception. The total mind can perceive things which are not even sense perceptions. For example, we have abstract concepts here. We have the concept of, say, jealousy. What is jealousy? Jealousy, people are jealous. They don't like what somebody else says. We say jealous people, but there when we say jealous person, we are using a physical eyes. But when the concept of jealousy itself is absorbed, it's a perception by the mind, directly. When you perceive jealousy as a concept, all jealous people are covered by that. There are so many similar concepts. All the concepts are born there. Ideas are born in the astral plane. Physical things are born here. Concepts and the concepts at causal plane, ideas at astral plane, and these at physical plane. In fact, Socrates and Plato have written notes about the power of the ideas playing at the astral plane, responsible for creation of everything on the physical plane. If an idea did not exist, that thing would not be there in a physical plane. If the concept were not there, you wouldn't even have an idea about it. So these are very interesting subjects to study in metaphysics. And if you like to study more, see where concepts come from. And if you really want to see them happening, not merely study them, then meditate and withdraw your attention from the physical body. When you withdraw your attention from the physical body and place it behind the eyes, from where it is notionally operating, when we are awake and we are sitting in a physical body, if we want to know where are we operating from as conscious beings, it doesn't take very long to know we are not operating from our hands and arms, we are not operating from our bellies and hearts, we are operating from the head, behind the eyes. That is why in a wakeful state, our notional point of where we appear to be operating from is behind the eyes. If you can withdraw your attention to that point, you can become unaware of the physical body and astral self opens up by itself. That's what you're putting your attention on. And we talk of imaginary things. Imagination is not as imaginary as you think. It looks imaginary to us because our constant definition of reality is physical reality. If we remove that definition, it will not be called imagination at all. Then this might be called imagination. That is being created from what we are imagining. Everything happening here is from the ideas being imagined by us. And imagination itself is coming from a higher concept, conceptual, creative power of the conscious, of the causal plane or the mind. So that is why we are misunderstanding these things, because we are taking our own reality of the physical reality as the only reality. And therefore everything else is imaginary or something to be achieved while we are sitting in a reality. We sometimes feel if we go to meditation, what we'll see? We are sitting here, we'll see something there, but we are really here. We don't realize what we are trying to see is where we are, and this is not real. It's the exact opposite. And we are so tied down to this reality, it becomes very hard for us even to meditate. When we meditate, we don't want to leave our reality. We say, I might die. Well, die from what? Die from something that is not real at all. When you awake to that level, you discover what you were looking at from where you will die was actually like death. You're sleeping. You're not even awake. So the wakefulness when you get through meditation, this has become a big hurdle of people because they don't want to leave the body. They think leaving the body is death. We don't know what death is. We don't know what happens after death. The fear of death, the fear of the unknown, what will happen after the body is left, is so strong. Therefore, to really have good meditation, good experiences, you have to cross that hurdle that the body is not yourself at all. There's a more stable body, which you are calling imaginary. That's far more stable, far longer life, far more effective, far more good in perception. That body is lying inside. When you awake to that body, you discover this was like a dream body. It's not real at all. But this transition from this one step is holding most of us back in the physical bodies. We don't want to leave the physical body. People are afraid of leaving the form in which they are existing even if they are existing in somewhat of a pain or not in a good position or in poverty, they don't want to leave the body, afraid of death. And this has been so built into all forms of life. Physical life has been created, so every form of life is considered to be real for the self in that form. And they don't want to leave that body. Even ants won't like to leave their body. Birds don't like to leave their body. No form of creature living in misery will not like to leave their body. So are we also afraid of leaving our bodies? We say it is death. We don't know what will happen. We don't want to die. So that is why dying, when we are afraid to die, we are even afraid to die while living. And yet every time we say the meditation creates an experience of dying while living, of which we are afraid. So this whole fear of the unknown, what will happen, is preventing us to have the higher experiences. This hurdle at some point has to be crossed. The best way to do it, and I recommend every time, is go very slow on this, step by step. Just go part of the way, have a little experience, and hold on to that, and next day go a little more. If you jump too high, the fear comes in, I'm dying, and you come back again to the body. So that is why slow and steady win the race. It's not something to leap forward. People say, I want to go higher ASAP. There's not an ASAP route, I can tell you, that you are not prepared for it, not ready for it. That is why practice your meditation in such a way that you advance slowly and get new experiences which open up gradually, and very gradually, as it happens, because the whole of us, the soul, the causal self, the astral self, the physical self, are all intact. It's not that we have left it somewhere else. Some people assume that just like a dream, we sleep in this body, the dream state we are walking somewhere else. And therefore, that self which walks away is not real. When we wake up, we are in our bed. So that means we were constantly always in our bed and we have now gone out somewhere for experience. That's what we imagine. That's what we think a dream is like. So we imagine we are sleeping somewhere in the astral plane, and this physical world we are running around over here, when we wake up, we'll find where we are sleeping. That is not true. The truth is that we are carrying our entire system together in this physical body, as we can carry our entire system in a dream state. When we wake up, we are waking up to a state which we were connected with before we went to sleep. But it does not mean that the self did not go along with the dream body. Self continues to travel, and when self travels, the things attached to the self, like the mind, the astral self, and the body that we are wearing, also travels with it. So our experiences have been so generated that we are taking the physical reality to be the most real. And there's one reason for it. The reason is that the power of making decisions, what we call free will, happens to exist only in this level. That makes it unique. We do not have the same power of free will in a dream, nor do we have the same power of free will in the astral plane, nor do we have the same power of free will or confusion what to do in the causal plane. We have a will, but it does not look like the free will we experience here. Here in the physical plane, we think it is entirely up to us to decide which way to go, what to do. This feeling that we can do anything we like occurs only really at two places. The physical plane, if you're wearing this physical body, and the top of the creation where the real self exists and is designed by true free will everything. Only two places have this exact complete feeling. Here is complete feeling of free will, and there is real free will. The real free will is creating the feeling of free will here. It was freely decided in the real free will that we should have that feeling. This is specially designed that in all the levels of consciousness that we can experience, the experience of this kind of free will should only take place in the human wakeful state. So that is why this is a very important part of creation, that we can, at one level of consciousness, have such kind of free will where we can even decide to leave and go back to our true home. We can't decide this anywhere else. Neither in the dreams, nor in the astral plane, nor in the causal plane, nor as souls. To go to our true home, we can make that decision here because of the experience of real free will, which is a part of the real free will that we originally designed to have this free will in the physical plane. So that is why this is a very important part of our creation. This makes it unique that we should feel more real here because of the feeling of free will. We do not feel as real in a dream, nor do we feel as real in the sense of free will in the astral plane. We can fly, do so many things, but we don't need to make decisions there. Here we need to make decisions. Why don't we need to make decisions in the dream? Very few decisions we make in the dream, because the dream sequences follow very rapidly after one another. That period when we are indecision, the period of dilemmas, is very limited, almost gone in the dream state. It all opens up in the physical wakeful state. When we go to the causal plane or the astral plane, there is no need for that because the future is known. We know what we have designed and we are going through it. It's a pattern we have designed, we're going through it. Here, ignorance of the future is responsible for our having very good feeling. We can decide what to do in that future. So that is why this experience of free will being so real in the physical plane makes us great candidates for even seeking to get out of the system. Not everybody wants to do it. We are enjoying our life. We are thinking it's real. Why would we try to get out of it? But the seeking only comes from inside, which is trapped in this body. The awareness comes at a time which we have planned. We have planned the time when, in spite of the fact that we are considering the whole world to be real, something is telling us this is not where we belong. This is not our true home. This feeling, this is not our true home, this is not where we belong, does not come by itself. It comes at a certain time after we have had several lifetimes of experiences, and it is designed by us. When that experience comes and we feel this is not the place, I had enough of this show. It wasn't as great as I thought it would be. I am tired of it. I've had enough of it. These feelings come at a time when we become seekers to escape from here. And that seeking is the secret. That seeking is not possible except with a real feeling of free will. And that feeling of free will generates that seeking, and seeking leads to finding. Seeking is the only requirement to find. No other requirement. There is no other condition at all. If you are a seeker, you will find. The rest is only a question of time. The rest is all, how much burden are you carrying of the stuff here? What is the burden we carry which prevents us to achieve our seeking fast enough? The burden is simply our attachments to this physical experience. We have attached ourselves, we desire more of these things, and therefore our attachment and desire are the burden we are carrying, and when we want to seek something, they pull us down. Our attachments pull us down. And it is very difficult to detach. As I explained many times, that you cannot practice detachment. When we try to practice detachment, we get more attached. Therefore, detachment comes by attaching to something else. So the whole play of this game is to be attached to something else, which is not the same level as physical. So when we want to get attached to something more real than this, we can't find anything here. So these perfect living masters come into our life at the right time when we need detachment, and somehow they pull us with their love. They start pulling us with their love. We don't know where we are being pulled. Are we being pulled physically? Are we being pulled in a sensory way? Are we being pulled mentally? Or are we being pulled more than that? When these feelings come up, we find that the pull is very deep. It's not coming from anywhere except from the soul itself. It's the soul that is occupying these bodies and now wants to return to its true home. The pull of the perfect living master that pulls us is coming from the soul. It is soul to soul. It's not something that's coming from the external self. Though we feel it's the external self also, because we don't know our soul, we don't know ourselves, and we only know our physical bodies. So it looks like the body is being attracted, and then when we find it's more than that, if you keep on examining, if you meditate and withdraw your attention and go to the next level, you'll find the attraction of that beautiful love of a master becomes much stronger. If you even leave the astral self and go to the mental self, you'll find that the love does not become less but even more. When you go beyond the mind, of course the love is pure and true. That you, then you find that's where the whole pull was coming from. Are not coming from the surface of the outside bodies we are wearing. So this is how the arrangement we have made to go back to our true home is simple, that we seek. When we seek, depending upon what we seek, masters appear in our life. Supposing we are an ultimate seeker of our true home, but we are not fully aware of what our true home is, and our idea of a true home is a very nice heavenly place. There are beautiful heavens in the astral plane. And our desire is to go back to a beautiful heaven, which is our true home. And we describe our heaven, and we describe our true home in heavenly terms. A master can appear, not a perfect living master. A master can appear who can tell us the methods of withdrawing our attention to the astral self and show the heaven which exists there. And we say we have reached our true home at that stage. It's only when we reach the heavenly stage and we are not satisfied, this is not what we are looking for. What makes us say that? A pull coming from within our heavenly state. Then we discover that the soul is not satisfied by going to a heaven. Soul wants to go to its true home from where it originated. It wants to become part of the totality of consciousness from where it emerged. When that pull comes, we go further, a new master appears. This all can happen while we are having a series of human births. Supposing somebody is in a heavenly state now, and the pull is to go beyond, but there is no free will available. Nobody can go from a heavenly state to a true home, to Sachkhand. So what will happen? If the pull is there, there will be rebirth into the physical plane, and a human body will create that seeking where the free will be such that I can seek. I want to go beyond. Heavenly experience is already sitting in the mind, in the memory, and want to go beyond that. Therefore, even if you have gone to the causal plane and the pull is coming from the causal plane, you will be born in a plane that is the free will can be experienced for seeking. The seeking will still come back here. The seeking is not the same at any other plane. That is why they give so much importance to the human body, the human form. The human form is considered next to God's form. They say made in the same image. When they say man is made in the same image, does it mean God has eyes and ears and nose like us? What is the meaning of the image? That man is made in God's image means God has real true free will and we have similar free will in the same image. It's the free will we are speaking about when we talk of the comparison with the creative power. So that is why it is very important for us to make the best use we can, if we are seekers, to seek while we are in the human body, to discover as much as we can while in the human body. As it happens, masters come into our life. Many masters come. They take us to where our seeking can be understood by our own self. And they take us there, but we are not satisfied. We move forward. Therefore, another master appears. Masters have appeared several times in our life, in several lifetimes. It's not a very fast job that you meet a master, there you go on. You prepared yourself over several lifetimes to meet a perfect living master. When we have had several experiences and we want to go to a true home beyond the mind, then only a perfect living master appears in our life. We don't find any masters. The masters we find are very often simple teachers who teach us the things that are written in our books. All the teachings have been recorded in every language in thousands of books today. Therefore, the teachers come to teach us. Perfect living masters don't come for that. They come to take us back home. We have understood the teachings. We have understood very well the teaching. In fact, we have understood too much of the teachings. And we don't want to go beyond anything that what we've been understanding. We get caught up in the understanding itself. Understanding is merely a mental function of the mind. And when we try to understand everything too much, we get into the trap of understanding. But the perfect living masters break our understanding by touching us with love, and understanding goes on the way. And suddenly love overpowers us. There is no greater power than the power of true love. The unconditional love, the kind of love we experience of this perfect living master, there is no match for it. That is why when the perfect living masters come into our life, they have come at a particular time in our own journey. Our spiritual journey started long ago, not when we meet a perfect living master. Actually, if you ask my honest opinion, I can tell you in a loud whisper, our journey, spiritual journey, does not begin when we meet a perfect living master. It ends there. We have done our journey when we meet the perfect living master. Now the journey starts for the perfect living master to take us home. That's the truth. But since our mind is continuously studying so much, continuously trying to understand, the mind says, now I have to struggle and do something as a next step. I have done so many steps, I read books, I went to so many masters, I have to now follow up a perfect master, and his teachings may be different. I have to follow that. The mind keeps on making us struggle even after that. And since the mind becomes almost an obstacle to even appreciating the love, even appreciating the pull that's coming, the mind is debating whether that is true or not. Since the mind has a natural tendency to create doubts and skepticism, therefore the mind comes in the way. So the pull has to be stronger to overcome the mind. So the mind comes in the way, therefore masters participate in the game of the mind. They say, yes, meditate more, read more books, understand more. We say, this is the true path. This is what we wanted. That's what the mind wanted. So they gave along with appeasing the mind. There was a man who gave a good good example of this. An old gardener, the one who worked in the garden, was planting a small little sapling of a bush, of a plant in the ground. And a passerby, young man, passed by and he saw the old man putting a little sapling of a plant inside. And he saw that there are so many weeds around the area where he's putting the plant. And he said, old man, you don't know, these are weeds around where you are planting, they'll kill your plant. So why are you feeding the weed? Then you're putting water on top, putting fertilizer for a little plant, and the weeds are getting very happy. They are growing with that food you are giving, water you are giving. And the old man says, have you ever planted this before? He said, no, I haven't, but I can see the common sense point of view that there are weeds around and you're putting the plant right there. He says, I have planted these before, the old man says. In the beginning, when I feed the plant, the weeds are also being fed. It's true, but the weeds remain young, the weeds remain small. And although they eat part of my food, a lot of my food they're eating, the plant keeps on growing. When it becomes big, it becomes like a big bush. And the shade of the same plant on those weeds kills the weeds. This is how the masters plant that love in our heart. Our desires of the world are weeds. And they also fulfill desires. He says, okay, very good, I'll fulfill your desire. We say, true master, he fulfilled my wish. I was sick, he gave me something, I got well. I was poor, I won a lottery. I got so many things from my master, he's a real master. This is just feeding the weeds, that we are trying to assess a master from what he is giving us physically here. These are all weeds. The weeds are growing, but when the love grows, we do not then care for the very things we thought were important. And we say, we don't want nothing but the master. We don't want anything from here, we just want the master. We want to go with him to a true home. So this example was given how masters participate in the functioning of the mind, in the functioning of our desires. They participate in it for the sake of the plant of love to grow. When the plant of love grows, we want nothing else except that love. So this is the way it is happening in the current situation. We are so placed that the masters work in this particular way. It does not mean that the feeding of the weeds is the spiritual teaching. The spiritual teaching is we have to go back home, but we have to handle the weeds on the way. We have to handle our desires on the way. We have to create a detachment by creating a new attachment to the plant and not to the weeds. We have to create no more love to the master. And master does it anyway. It's not that it's a task given to us. People say, masters say, love and devotion is the way. How can we develop love and devotion? When they say, how can you develop love and devotion, they make it like a mental exercise. That you have to develop it in some way, then the mind has to think, how can I develop more love and devotion? What more should I do? What physical action should I do? What mental action do I do to bring devotion and love? It doesn't come. And then we say, master, we tried, it doesn't come. Well, it is not an exercise of the mind at all. Devotion comes automatically when love is experienced more. Experience more of the love, devotion is automatic. Devotion is an automatic response built into us. That when we feel the love, we get devoted. We want to move forward. We want to go and serve. We want to please the beloved from where the pull is coming. That is why the love and devotion that we talk of is not a mental exercise. It's merely arising from appreciating the love we are experiencing. Now, I use this word appreciation. Very important word. Somebody asked me, we expect so many things from God. Does he expect anything from us? I said, yes, he does. One word, appreciation. He expects that what he gives us, we appreciate. If you appreciate, love and devotion comes automatically. Therefore, appreciation, gratitude, thanking is the secret of creating love and devotion. Every time you feel something has come from a master, say thank you. Love and devotion will grow. Express the appreciation what you're getting. Love and devotion will grow. So that is why love and devotion is not an exercise of mental exercise at all, nor a physical exercise. It is something that's coming from appreciation of something that the soul is feeling, that the inner self is feeling, that love is being felt. You're just appreciating it. And every little act that happens, even physically or mentally, which you feel is coming from the master's grace, master's blessing, is an appreciation. That is why we use these words, grace, blessing. We use these words because they don't mean anything physically. And yet they mean everything for the sake of love and devotion. And we can appreciate a blessing, we can appreciate grace more because they are not physical. That is why the appreciation of those generates love and devotion. I am sharing these things with you because of the wonderful experiences I've had with the perfect living master, Baba Sawan Singh. It's such a great journey that he has proven that there is nothing better than that. And I'm today sitting here as an example of telling you there is nothing better than that. If somebody can come and tell me that the experience is generated by this master's teachings, which I'm sharing with you, anything is better, I'll take it immediately. I've spent my whole life waiting for that. Nobody is able to produce anything better than that. That is why I congratulate all of you that you are lucky, that you are following a path which is a path of the soul, of the spirit, not of the body, not of your minds, not of your senses. It's a path of your soul. You are ready. That is why you are here. Your soul is ready to go back to a true home. That's why you're here. You have had experiences before that. You have had experiences with other masters also. And those experiences were either physical or astral or mental. And you wanted to go beyond that. Therefore, you are here. So this seeking of the soul comes at the right time. Your time has come. Congratulations. I'll have a break now and see you in the afternoon for a short while at 3:30 p.m.